la termodinámica? ¿Alguno de ustedes puede decírmelo? No levanten la mano todos al tiempo que me aturullo. Como su nombre indica, la termodinámica estudia el movimiento del calor, más estrictamente las transformaciones de la energía. Porque ya saben ustedes que la energía puede adoptar muchas formas.
So here's Manuel with
Les
his
presento
steam
a Manuel
engine.
Suárez, que va a ser el profesor auxiliar.
Just to note, this is not a regular steam engine, it's basically a Hero, a Leo pile kind of thing, where steam just pushes the boat
on the water. Manel, explíqueles cómo funciona antes de hacer la demostración.
Este cuenquito contiene el combustible que alimentará la llama. La llama calentará el agua de este depósito. El agua se expandirá al calentarse y saldrá por estos dos tubitos impulsando el barco.
Qué bonito, Manel.
Precioso. Pongámoslo en funcionamiento.
Toma el mío.
No importa, lo que están viendo también responde a los principios de la termodinámica.
Los principios de los que hablamos no solo rigen completamente nuestra vida, sino que finalmente determinarán nuestro destino y el de todo el universo. Prepárense para emprender, a hombros de gigantes, un nuevo salto en la historia de la ciencia. Bienvenidos al apasionante.
This whole thing about heat death here, we'll get to that in a minute. But then again, this is a little bit of confused scientific folklore. You see where he's talking about terrifying the world. There's nothing terrifying about the whole thing. That's just confusion in the mind of the physicist, or the person ignorant of the extrapolation of what Clausius, he's the guy who invented the whole subject. Here's an original English copy of Clausius' book. There's Clausius right there. He's the guy who invented thermodynamics. So the heat death extrapolation is a little bit something that's lost in translation. Touch on that when we get to the formula section. Pause for 1 minute. Okay, so correctly, once you understand passion in terms of chemical thermodynamics, there's nothing terrifying about the world. This is resolve ignorance. So, for example, in Christianity, if you're ignorant or not, if you weren't taught the physical, chemical, thermodynamical view of the world, you might be told that if you commit some sin, you're going to burn in hell. So that's a terrifying view of things. Once you understand hell, again, is heat. Once you, thermo and hell, and they all come from Egyptian mythologies, we'll touch on in a second here. Or as I might, we'll touch on right now, just so we can get on the same page. So right here, it's in the book. I really didn't know this before, but the TH of thermodynamics and the TH of theology both come from the sun symbol, theta. So we'll take a look at that from the book here. What is the human chapter? Now we have to have the word in the unlearned chapter. All this stuff about we were taught is historically over the last 5,000 years, you have to unlearn if you're going to accept a new version of. So here we are in the. So theta. Thermodynamics, theta comes from this symbol, theta. And that's a symbol of the sun. And inside of the theta supposedly is the snake or the evil that does battle. It's called a pep. It does battle with the sun every night. It goes back 6,000 years. So here we have. This is the origin of chemistry over here. Let's see. Chemistry origin. Cheme is the name of the black soil that's left on the banks of the Nile when river floods. There's the cheme. That's where the name chemistry comes from. So the Nile River floods carries down this black soil from the Ethiopian mountains, and it's left on the banks of the Nile. So the Egypt is called the Chemia. And the Egyptians were called Chemites before the Greeks renamed it as Egyptos or land of the god Ptah, which is another rescript. But this contrasted with the red soil, which doesn't grow life, versus the banks were called Chem, because it grew water plus the soil plus the sun grew plants and humans. And this got re-scripted like this here over the years. Came to alchemy, chemistry. But thermodynamics we have over here. So we see that originally it was called mechanical theory of heat by Clausius. But then Maxwell started calling it theta delta. So the theta here is the sun with the snake on the end, snake on it. And the delta is the Egyptian pyramid. So in the Egyptian theology or cosmology view, there was a flood, then land rose, and then the sun was burst forth out of the tip of the pyramid. So thermodynamics and theology are both have the same etymological origin. There's no terrifying worldview as they talk about in this film. Very peaceful once you understand their situation. So here we have. There's theta. So the historians have told us. Porphyry says that this thing is the world's soul plus the enad, of the nine gods of Heliopolis. Philo of Byblos says that this is the snake head or the eye of God. That this is the snake body, but correctly this is the sun. And then John Lydus says that this is the cosmos. That's the world, and then this is the good snake, and then Damian. So here we go, we're getting back to Nietzsche's A Taste Beyond Good and Evil. So you open this up here. We have it. If you can, this is the maze here, to escape the constraints of Judeo-Christianity. You start here. So we're going to start here, and you'll see that this was transcripted over into Judaism, Christianity, Islam, and Hinduism. Right over here we have, there's the snake. These are some of the symbols that got translated over. There's the symbol of Heliopolis, which is the sun with the cross symbol in it. You see the cross on top of the whatever this is. There's water, and this is bread. All right, so getting back to the movie.
Mundo de las leyes de la termodinámica.
Thermodynamics is present in everything we encounter, from the world around us to ourselves and our machines of everyday life. We cannot get away from it.
Quantum physics, astronomy, and even biology all are embedded with thermodynamics. It is sort of a surprising that a theory that was developed to improve steam-powered machines has ended up with such deep philosophical consequences.
Novelist and cultural analyst C.P. Snow once said that every educated person should know the second law of thermodynamics, and that not knowing it was like having never read a work of Shakespeare.
Para hablar de termodinámica, tenemos que referirnos a un sistema. Tomemos en este caso.
All are embedded with thermodynamics. It is sort of surprising that a theory that was developed to improve steam-powered machines has ended up with such deep philosophical consequences.
Novelist and cultural analyst C.P. Snow.
Oh, this is really nice right here. Well, C.P. Snow gave this Reed lecture in 1959. In front of an audience of large, the audience wasn't important, but he said that the modern intellectual community is divided between two cultures. One who understands Clausius, which is what we've just shown here, and then one who understands Shakespeare, which is my Shakespeare collected works is boxed up right now. But basically he said, if you can either understand Romeo and Juliet, or you can understand Clausius, but one person after 1959 can no longer understand both. So that's kind of where there was a rift or division. And he was frustrated about that, because he was a physicist, but then he also went into literature. So just to give you one example of this, I'm going to be speaking in next month at the one of the Two Cultures Thermodynamics Conference. I'll be I'm one of the organizers of this conference. So in 42 days, I'll be speaking at International Conference on Thermodynamics 2.0. And the idea here is to connect the natural sciences with the social sciences to attempt to remedy the C.P. Snow rift that was formed in 59. There's about 60 speakers have sent abstracts. And with the virus, we're doing a Zoom conference, supposedly, so we'll see how that turns out. But let's see if they talk about snow in here. I don't think there's no snow, but basically it's attempt to connect the natural sciences meets social sciences. So it's so here is some of the speakers here. Stephen Keen, he's a new one, I haven't heard about it. This one here, this woman from, I think, Romania. Just learned about her, Cadlin. They spent like 20, 30 years trying to connect thermodynamics to the social sciences. This, there's Terence Deacon, I've already argued with him before, and Adrian Bajan, he's a smart guy from, and then, let's see here. Let's see, there's me right there. So I'm helping organize the whole conference. And so this is kind of like a realization. It's not the first realization of C.P. Snow's call for need to unify things, but that's where we stand right now.
Once said that every educated person should know the second law of thermodynamics.
This is really nice.
And that not know. Novelist and cultural analyst C.P. Snow once said that every educated person.
Okay, so here we are.
Has ended up with such deep philosophical consequences.
Novelist and cultural analyst C.P. Snow once said that every educated person.
Alright, so here we are. We're basically at the core of the whole film. But the integral, I mean, the sum of all the heat, this is partial differential, inexact differential means it's like a theoretical version of heat. It's symbolized wrong here. And that's T is the absolute temperature of the system. So say you have a boundary, which we'll talk about shortly, and, for example, a social system where the movie's taking place. So heat is going into the system, which will be a plus, and it's also going out of the system, which will be a negative. But we can't formulate that mathematically, so we have to divide this inexact differential of heat by the absolute temperature, and then we get a state function according to the Euler reciprocity relationship. So in an ideal situation, which we'll talk about, which comes from Lavoisier, the sum of all these are called transformation equivalents, which we just mentioned, formulated by Thomson and Clausius in 1654. The sum of all these is equal to zero in a reversible cyclical process. But in a irreversible cyclical process, the sum of all these is going to be have a certain value, which is going to equal to n, which is called the sum of all uncompensated transformations. So basically this means that when you put heat into a system and you take heat out of a system, you would think that it would go back to the initial state. But according to Clausius, which is the modern view we have now, some of this heat's going to be absorbed in terms of the work that the molecules of the system do on each other. That's called internal work. So whenever you're in the film, when you hear us talk about disorder increase, that's called the ignorant view. And then the next clip here, you'll see the Boltzmann interpretation.
Should know the second law of thermodynamics.
So right here, that's carved above his tombstone. And just to point out a few things here. So just to point out a few things here, I recently purchased the Boltzmann, the new 2018 book, Anxiety and the Equation. This is by 2018 by Eric Johnson. And basically, Clausius or Boltzmann, this equation wasn't even formulated like this by Boltzmann. It was formulated by Planck, and this is where quantum theory comes from. But W is the Varsheinlich kite. It means the multiplicity of the states of the gas phase system. Logarithm, this is the Boltzmann constant, that S is the entropy. So the he took the idea that if you add heat to a gas phase system, it changes the number of states or number of positions that particles of a gas phase system could be in. This is kind of like gas theory thermodynamics, but a lot of people apply this equation to chemical thermodynamics and also social thermodynamics. So there's a little bit of confusion here, but Boltzmann, when you're going to see in the film, they talk about thermodynamics founders ending their own existence by their own hand. So Boltzmann was one of those, and he hung himself where he was on vacation in Vienna, I think, with his wife and his daughter. And because he was sick, I guess, but he also had pressure from Ernest Mach and two other people who denied that atoms existed. They said his whole theory was bunk because it was based on atoms. And so there's a whole, we'll look at that in a minute.
And that not knowing it was like having never read a work of Shakespeare.
Para hablar de termodinámica, tenemos que referirnos a un sistema. Tomemos en este caso el sistema humanidad, con sus miles de partículas individuales moviéndose e interactuando. Y tomemos algunas partículas. Por ejemplo, la partícula Manel y la partícula Elena, que aún no se conocen. Lo primero que debemos saber es que todo sistema termodinámico tiende hacia el equilibrio. Pero no se dejen engañar por lo bien que suena esta palabra. Es justamente la falta de equilibrio lo que podría dar a las partículas Manel y Elena la oportunidad de encontrarse e interactuar, de construir algo juntos. Equilibrio en este caso significa dispersión de las partículas y ausencia de actividad, de intercambios de calor. Siento decirles que es eso hacia lo que tendemos.
So to comment on this, the particle model is incorrect. It's more humans are. When you hear particle, that means he's using gas phase models. He's thinking of humans as particles moving in space, but humans are